بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. وأفضل التحية وأكمل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا ورسولنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، فعن أبي مالك الأشعري رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: الطهور شطر الإيمان، والحمد لله تملأ الميزان، وسبحان الله والحمد لله تملأان أو تملأ ما بين السماء والأرض، والصلاة نور، والصدقة برهان، والصبر ضياء، والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك، كل الناس يغدو فبائع نفسه فمعتقها أو موبقها. رواه مسلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما. My dear brothers and my dear sisters, Alhamdulillah, this is now we have reached hadith number 23 in the collection of Imam Abu Zakariya Yahya ibn Sharaf al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, his Arba'een. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this life, He has bestowed upon us so many blessings, so many ni'am, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. The way to try to enumerate and calculate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, you will never be able to do so. لَا تُحْصُوهَا. Certainly Allah is the all-forgiving, the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with life, hayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with iman, faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with health, siha. And truly we only really value a blessing when it is taken away from us. Like in the situation we are in now, where we are unable to perhaps go for a picnic in the park with our families, we truly realize blessings when they are taken away from us. And among the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Malik al-Muluk, has bestowed upon us is, as he said, Jalla wa'ala, وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَا أَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ. Mention the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. When Allah subhanahu blesses with something, we are meant to proclaim and speak about the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the ending of Surah Al-Duha, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. As for the blessing of your Lord, then speak, tell people about the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, but only tell those who you love. Only tell those who have your best interests at heart. Inform them of the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. So here Allah says, وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. Mention the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, and that which He has sent down to you from the kitab and from the hikmah. And that blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down to you from the kitab, from the Quran, from the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the hikmah and the wisdom. And all of the mufassirun, all of them, they mention that the hikmah means the way, the methodology, the path, the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Such a great blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. The Quran and the sunnah, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already promised and vowed to keep preserved and protected till the end of times. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Certainly we have sent down upon you this dhikr. Allah didn't say we have sent inna nahnu nazzalna al-Qur'ana. Allah used the word dhikr. We have sent down upon you the remembrance. And we are those who shall protect and guard that dhikr. Dhikr meaning the Qur'an and its explanation, the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that we may understand this Quran, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the manual for guidance in our life, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended for us to understand His Quran. Not so that anybody, any Amr, Bakr and Zayd can come and give their own interpretation and say, no, according to me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الصَّلَاةِ. Do not come close to the prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, do not pray. No, rather Allah Jalalul Ikram has sent, along with His Quran, He sent the explanation to His Quran also, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَى لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. We've sent down upon you, O my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this dhikr. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the same word, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَى لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that you, O my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so you may explain to the people, مَا نُزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, what is it that has been sent down upon them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave us with His Quran and that's it. No, rather He sent its explanation also, as it's famous from a Sayyida Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she was asked, when our mother was asked about the akhlaq of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she replied saying, Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, his khuluq, his etiquettes, his manners was the Quran. He was a walking, talking explanation of the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down to us, so that we may follow him alayhi salatu wa salam, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent with him. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. In the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, you have certainly the best pattern of conduct to follow, a living, walking, talking explanation of the Quran. That which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved along with His Quran. The books of the Hadith were preserved along with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to give you a brief glimpse as to how important it is that we understand the rank and the position of this explanation of the Quran, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, in the subcontinent, the late, many of the ulama in the subcontinent, their teacher, meaning Muhaddith al-Asr, Hafidh Muhammad Qutbi rahimahullah ta'ala, he used to say the famous statement that in order to understand the Hadith and the importance of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we cannot understand the Quran. Who is it that told us about the Quran? Who is it that told us Iqra was sent down upon him? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha and told her the whole incident, and she, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to us, Zamiruni, Dathiruni, cover me up, I fear for my life. And then he told the whole incident, what happened, that Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam came to him and embraced him and released him and then said to him, Iqra. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ma ana biqari, I'm unable to read. And then again he embraced and took hold of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and released him again and said, Iqra. And all the story we know. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Sahih Bukhari, all these books of a hadith, he informed Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon him, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, the first five ayat of Surah Al-Alaq. Meaning it's through the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam that we come to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Quran upon us. So this is today's hadith, the hadith of Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala an, which has been recorded and preserved for us in the Sahih of Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala, Abu Hussein Muslim ibn al-Hajjaj ibn Muslim al-Qushayri al-Nisaburi rahimahullah ta'ala, the prized student of Imam Al-Hafidh Al-Hujja Sayyid Al-Fuqaha Imam Al-Muhaddithin Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. Such a great relationship they had between them, Imam Al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala. Once Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala in front of the whole Jami' Masjid, in front of all of the people, he asked Imam Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala about and all of his tashreeh, all of his explanation, why the hadith is ma'lul, why the hadith is, has hidden defects into it. And then Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, Ya Ustad al-Ustadeen, wa ya Shaykh al-Muhaddithin, wa ya Tabib al-Hadith fi ibadi, da'ni uqabbilu rijlayka. O teacher of teachers, O Shaykh of the Muhaddithin, O doctor of the hadith and the defects, allow me to kiss your feet, O Imam al-Bukhari. He said about Imam al-Bukhari again in another place, he said, أشهد أن ليس في الدنيا مثلك ولا يبغضك إلا حاسد. The, oh my teacher, oh Imam al-Bukhari, I bear witness that there's nobody on this earth similar to you, and nobody will have envy and jealousy of you except somebody who was a true hasid, somebody who's a truly an envious person will be envious of you, oh Imam al-Bukhari. So Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala, he is the one who he records was this hadith of Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala, and he's from the famous Qabila, the famous tribe of Ash'ariyin, who they are the most famously known for, of Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala, who at his hands more than 50 of his tribesmen, they accepted Islam. And he made hijrah because originally they are from Yemen. The tribe of Banu Ash'ar, they were from Yemen. And then he made hijrah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Not much is known about Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu. In fact, there's even ikhtilaf in his name. Is his name Al-Harith ibn Asim? Or is his name Ka'b ibn Asim al-Ash'ari? But there's one hadith which is very beautiful in the Musadraq of Imam Hakim, Musadraq of Imam Ahmad, and Imam Dhahabi. He also declares it to be Sahih, likewise Shaykh al-Bani, where he says that when he was about to die, Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, he said, O people of the Ash'ari tribe, come close to me. فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ فَسَلْنِي, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam saying, حُلْوَةُ الدُّنْيَا مُرَّةُ الْآخِرَةِ وَمُرَّةُ الدُّنْيَا حُلْوَةُ الْآخِرَةِ, that the sweetness of this life, it is the bitterness of the Akhirah. And the bitterness of this life, it is the sweetness of the Akhirah. Meaning all this hardship we endure in this dunya, it is for us to have ease in the Akhirah. For those who have ease in this life, they will have hardship in the Akhirah. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in Sahih Muslim, Al-Dunya Sijrul Mu'min wa Jannatul Kafir. That this life, it is the prison of a believer and it is the paradise of a disbeliever. That whatever they want, they can do. They are free to do whatever they want. They have nobody dictating upon them, no legislation to follow, because a believer is bound by the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to live his life or her life pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not according to their own shahawat, not according to their own ahwa, their own desires, their own whims, their own wants, rather to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, he said that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he said, At-tuhuru shatrul iman. Purity, it is half of faith. And what a timely hadith it is for us to discuss this hadith. A time which we are told to be extra in our cleanliness, to wash our hands for 20 seconds non-stop. Every time we enter into our houses to wash our hands because of this disease that has befallen this whole world. And this is the teaching of our deen, that At-tuhuru shatrul iman. Purity, cleanliness, it is half of faith. And some of the a'imma of hadith, they express and they explain this hadith meaning al-iman here to be as-salah. Al-iman here to mean the prayer, to mean salah. At-tuhuru shatrul iman. At-tuhuru, cleanliness, it is half of the prayer. And why is that? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah regarding the tahweel al-qibla, when the qibla was changed, as the Muslims first used to face toward Bayt al-Maqdis in Jerusalem while they were praying. And then when they were in Medina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave the order to change the qibla. Now you should face toward Makkah al-Mukarramah, face toward the Ka'bah al-Musharrafah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. We have seen you, O my Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lifting your face toward the heavens. قد نرى تقلب وجهك في السماء. So we will change the qibla to one which you are pleased with, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So face toward the Masjid al-Haram. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these ayat he says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was not one to make waste your iman. Because the Sahaba alayhi wa ridwan, they were of the thinking that perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he altered and he changed the qibla, meaning now that those prayers we prayed, they have gone null and void. They have been rendered null and void now, because now we are changing and we are facing the opposite direction. As in Medina, it was north of Mecca. So when the Muslims were in Medina, they would face Baitul Maqdis, which was toward the north. And now they would face toward the south, the complete 180 degree turn toward the Kaaba to Musharrafa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave them reassurance. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was not one to render your iman, meaning your salah, null and void. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he calls salah as iman here. And al-tuhuru, purity, is part of the salah. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تُقْبَلُ صَلَاتٌ بِغَيْرِ طُهُورٍ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept any prayer without tuhur, meaning without wudu. Like no Muslim can pray any prayer without having wudu. Wudu is a condition for prayer. So here, al-tuhuru shatr al-iman. Cleanliness, meaning wudu, is half of iman, meaning salah. But we find the other opinion to be more valid, to have more weight to it. And that is, al-tuhuru shatr al-iman. Iman here to mean actually iman, to mean faith. Because iman, it is what they call in Arabic takhliya and tahliya. Part of it is removing and part of it is beautifying and adorning. Meaning that our iman is found primarily in our hearts. Iman, the asl and the base of iman is in our hearts. Even though with Ahlul Sunnah, an iman, it is tasdeequn bil qalb. It is to affirm with the heart. Taqreer, and it is to affirm with the tongue and to act according with the limbs. But the actual base of iman, no doubt, it is in the heart of a person. So the iman of a person, it is to empty and to relieve your heart of all types of shirk, takhliya. And it's also tahliya, to adorn your iman with ta'at, with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to adorn your iman with belief in Him, to adorn your iman with good deeds, with a'mal saliha, with hasanat, to relieve and to empty your heart, empty your iman of all types of shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not spare any of them. In Surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned more than 18 prophets and messengers, one after the other, 18 of them in succession. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions that were they to commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have rendered all of their deeds null and void. وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Were those 18 prophets and messengers to commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah would have rendered all of their deeds null and void. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can you believe it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that has been revealed to you. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. It has been revealed to you, as it was revealed to those who came before you. لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Were you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Were you to commit shirk? لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكُ. All of your deeds would have been rendered null and void, and you would have been among those who were losers. If this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then how about me and how about you? So a part of our iman is takhliya, to empty our hearts of all types of shirk, and tahliya, to adorn our iman with good deeds and pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our a'mal salihah. So, at-tuhuru shatr al-iman. Tuhur, Here meaning to cleanse and to purify your heart of shirk. At-tuhuru shatrul iman, it is half of iman. And shatr also, it does not mean literally nisf. Rather, it means shatr means part, where something is divided into two halves, and the percentages may differ, maybe 60, 40, 70, 30. So there are two parts, but they are not equally half. So at-tuhuru shatrul iman. At-tuhuru, purity in tawheed. It is half of iman, because iman is to empty your heart of shirk and to adorn it with good deeds. So half of your iman is at-tuhuru, purification. Then the Prophet sallallahu says, Walhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. And the saying of Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it fills the mizan. It fills the mizan, fills the scales. Which scales? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ لِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ تَعْمُمُ الْقِيَامَةِ On the day of resurrection, we will bring the scales of justice. وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ لِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-muqsit. He is al-adil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-just. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He loves equity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah la yadhlimu mithqala dharra. Even one atom's weight, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not act on any form of injustice. So, the mawazin, the scales that will be brought in Yawm al-Qiyamah, that which fills them is the statement of Alhamdulillah. Walhamdulillahi tamla'u al-mizan. It fills the scales, it makes heavy the scales, and all of us we want for our scales to be heavy on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Nobody amongst us wants our scales to be light of good deeds and heavy of bad deeds on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Rather, all of us we want, and all of us we like, and all of us we work for our deeds to be heavy on Yawm al-Qiyamah. فَأَمَّا مَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُ فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَةٍ رَاضِيَةٍ Whoever it is that his scales are heavy on Yawm al-Qiyamah, then he will be in an everlasting life of bliss in Al-Jannah al-Firdaws. Whoever it is that his scales are heavy. And what is it that makes these scales heavy? وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ تَمْلَأُ الْمِيزَانِ The saying of Alhamdulillah makes heavy the scales. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Subhanallah, walhamdulillahi tamla'an, aw tamla'u ma bayna as-samai wal-ard. And Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, these two phrases, they fill what is between the heavens and the earth. And if you look at the way that the ruwat of hadith, the narrators of hadith, how true they were to their words, that even if they were unsure about something, they would narrate it as they heard it. As in this hadith, وَالْحَوْ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ تَمْلَأَنْ أَوْ تَمْلَأُ شَكَّ الرَّاوِي One of the ruwat, he had a bit of doubt, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, تَمْلَأَنْ أَوْ تَمْلَأُ So just to show the academic prowess, the ruwat of hadith, even whatever they were unsure about, they said it as they heard it. Even though it makes no difference, the meaning is the same. وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ تَمْلَأَنَّ أَوْ تَمْلَأُ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ These two statements, سُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ fill whatever is between the heavens and the earth. And if you know that this universe is constantly expanding, so whatever is between this earth, whatever is between the crust of this earth, and the ever-expanding universe, all of that is filled with good deeds with us saying Subhanallah walhamdulillah. And here, if we pause for a moment and we think and we ponder, how are we with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we truly live with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ رَبَّهُ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرَ رَبَّهُ مَثَلُ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ The similitude of the one who makes mention of his Lord and the one who makes no mention of his Lord is like the similitude of the living and the dead. Some of us are partially alive, some of us are partially dead. Some of us who, whenever we pray, When we finish our prayer, we quickly, subhanAllah, 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 30 feet, and quickly to get it over and done with. Whenever we leave the house, we make the dhikr to leave the house, Bismillah tawakkaltu ala Allah wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Just quickly to get it over and done with. Whenever we enter into the house, whenever we sit in the car, quickly just to get it over and done with. We don't really live according to the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't really live tasting the beauty of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you think most of the ibadat, they are legislated for the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was discussing in the beginning of Surah Ta'a with Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, He mentioned, إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي. Certainly it is me. I am Allah. There is none worthy of worship except me. فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِيمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. So worship me and establish the prayer. وَأَقِيمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. For the establishment of my dhikr. And the Hajj, all the deeds, all the rituals of Hajj, Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, said that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الطَّوَافُ بِالْبَيْتِ وَبَيْنَ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةِ وَرَمْيُ الْجِمَارِ لِإِقَامَةِ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. That only the tawaf, the circumambulation around the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, around the Kaaba, and the running between Safa and Marwa, and the stoning of the Jimar, the Jamarat, لِإِقَامَةِ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, has been placed for the establishment of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talks about His dhikr, when He talks about His mentioning Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Ahzab, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, O you who believe, اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا. Mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the remembrance. What kind of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Should we remember you a limited amount of times a day? 10 times, 20 times, 50 times? Should we remember you a little bit or a lot? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dhikran kathira, a multitude of times. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dhikran kathira. So we should all go back and learn and read up about the virtues of mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how we should live our lives tasting the sweetness of mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not to get everyone doing it, not to just read it so that we are protected, but so that we can remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and really taste the sweetness of mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Mention me, O Adam. Mention me, O Yahya, O Muhammad, O Abdullah, O Fatima, O Aisha. Mention me, أَذْكُرْكُمْ. فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Mention me, and I will mention you. How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention us? As the famous hadith of Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever we mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions us. Whenever we mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi nafsi, dhakartuhu fi nafsi. Whenever we mention the name of Allah in ourselves, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions us in His self subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ ذَكَرِنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّنْهُ. And whoever is that mentions me in a group of people, in a gathering of people, whenever he's with his friends, whenever he's with his family, he mentions Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that person among the malaika alayhi salatu wa salam. So we should try make a habit of making the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not just making the dhikr of Allah just to get it over and done with, but rather to really feel and to taste the sweetness of mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not just for the sake of it, but when we mention the name of Allah, whenever we say Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah, تَمْلَأُ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ, then all of the space between the heavens and the earth is filled with good deeds, filled with us, or good deeds of us saying Subhanallah. And subhanAllah, you know, Sayyidina Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, once he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَيُّ الْكَلَامِ أَفْضَلْ, which of speech is the most beloved to Allah subhanahu, is the best of speech? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sahih Muslim, said, مَصْطَفَ اللَّهُ لِمَلَائِكَتِهِ, that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for his angels, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّعُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. The angels replied, why we sing your praise, وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّعُ بِحَمْدِكَ, we glorify you, we say, we make the speech of you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the speech that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for his angels. مَصْطَفَ اللَّهُ لِمَلَائِكَةٍ سُبْحَانَ wa وَبِحَمْدِهِ Subhanallah al-Azim, you know kalimatani, the beautiful hadith, kalimatani, habibatani, ila al-Rahmani, khafifatani, ala al-Lisani, thaqilatani, fi al-Mizan. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, Subhanallah al-Azim. Two phrases, beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which are extremely light on our tongues to utter, but they are extremely heavy and weighty in the scales of good deeds. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, Subhanallah al-Azim. We should get used to, now most of us who are sitting idly in our houses, most of us who are getting bored of our family members, going upstairs, downstairs into the garden, we are getting bored of each other. Why not just sit and mention, whenever you get bored, just sit and mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. What will you lose from this? Absolutely nothing. But what will you gain from this? A huge amount of reward with us in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So alhamdulillah tamla' al-mizan. Alhamdulillah subhanallah alhamdulillah tamla'ana wa tamla'u ma bayna as-sama'i wal-ard. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went on to give us the fada'il of some good deeds, the virtues of some good deeds. He said, وَالصَّلَاةُ nur, and the prayer, whatever type of prayer it is, whether it is nafil, whether it is fard, whether it is in jama'ah, whether it is by yourself, whether it is in safar or in hadar, وَالصَّلَاةُ nur. The salah is a light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How is the salah a light? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions light on Yawm al-Qiyamah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Hadid, يَوْمَ تَرَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَسْعَى نُورٌ بَيْنَ أَيْدِهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ. That the believers of Yawm al-Qiyamah, they'll be on the day of darkness, a gloomy, frightening day. The believers, male and female, they'll be running with a light between them. A light, they will have a light on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala in Sahihain Bukhari Muslim said that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about his ummah, إِنَّ أُمَّتِي يَأْتُونَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ غُرًّا مُحَجَّلِينَ مِنْ أَثَرِ الْوُضُوءِ. That my ummah will come on يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ غُرًّا مُحَجَّلِينَ, having radiant, bright faces and arms and legs, مِنْ أَثَرِ الْوُضُوءِ, from the trace of wudu which they used to perform before they used to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as-salatu nur, the prayer is a light. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu says that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that famous hadith, bashir al-mashaheena fi al-zulami ila al-masajid bin nur tammi yawm al-qiyamah. Give glad tidings to those who walk in the darkness of night, in Fajr and Isha, to the masajid, to pray, to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who make that effort, give them glad tidings, bin nur tammi yawm al-qiyamah, of a perfect, complete, absolute light on yawm al-qiyamah. As-salatu nur, the prayer is a light. Was-sadaqatu burhan, and giving in charity, it is a burhan, it is an evidence. It is an evidence of what? Of the truthness, of the truthfulness of a person's belief, of a person's iman. Because our wealth, it is beloved to us. It is something that is close to our heart, something that we don't want to part with easily. And so when we go shopping, we try to look for the cheapest of all brands. And so we're shopping online, what do? We click the price, low to high. Because wealth is something that is beloved to us, something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ingrained to be beloved in our zuyina linnasi hubbu shahawati min al-nisa'i wal-baneen wal-qanatir al-muqantarati min al-dahabi wal-fitta. In Surah Al-Imran, made beautiful for mankind. Zuyina linnasi hubbu is the love of the desire of spouses and children and gold.